Dive-In.
Bienvenidos a Dive-In.
Witajcie na festiwalu Dive-In.
Welcome to the Dive-In Festival.
Welcome to Dive-In.
Bienvenidos a Dive-In.
Welcome to Dive-In.
Mabuhay sa Dive-In Kapistahan.
Üdvözlünk a Dive-In Fesztiválon.
Dobro pasalvit na Fesztivál Dive-In.
Bohim a baim. Bólit loritánu.
Dive-In utcabe. Apna de sokol ke janai. Shadur amontran.
Dive-In e yokuso.
Benvenuti al Dive-In Festival.
Dive-In Festivaline, hoş geldiniz.
Aklen, we confi Dive-In.
Okay, good morning and welcome everyone to another installment of the Dive-In Festival. Dive-In is an initiative started by Lloyd's of London, and the focus was really just to unpack diversity and inclusion in the insurance industry. As we celebrate our Heritage Month in South Africa, in spring, it's a very cold spring day, we welcome everybody in South Africa who's participating. We welcome everybody who's participating globally. I think the one thing about being on lockdown and having to do these things virtually is that it expands our reach, and we can actually attend other Dive-In festivals from across the globe. So that is very exciting. Our theme for today is Black Lives Matter: the impact, the understanding, and the acceptance. My name is Anele Dindwa. I will be your host this morning. Dive-In in South Africa is brought to you by AIG, Aon, MARSH, CHUBB, and the IISA. Now, this topic is a sensitive one, but I think it's an important one. 2020, once again, we've seen the plight of Black people from across the globe as we battle psychological and institutional racism. And throughout the discussions today, this is the very sensitive but necessary topic that we need to engage in. I'm going to introduce you in a moment to our first speaker, Conrad. Throughout the program, please, we are encouraging you to participate in the chat box. You are encouraged to type in your questions. And after the speaker, we will have a Q&A so that we can engage even further in terms of the content that we will be presenting. Now, a conversation on racism with Chester Missing and Conrad Kock. Racism is a topic everybody wants to talk about, but then nobody actually wants to talk about. In this hilarious hour, South Africa's most famous puppet, the double Emmy-nominated Chester Missing, refuses to give his talk on racism until his ventriloquist, Conrad Kock, who happens to have a master's degree in social anthropology, understands his own racism. We will be discussing white privilege, apartheid, having Black friends, people who don't see color, prejudice, and a lot more. Conrad will be using humor to deliver this very serious message. I must also add that Conrad and Chester were the first recipients of the Ahmed Katrada Foundation's Anti-Racism Award. Now, in the wave of the Black Lives Matter, there is no room for silence on these issues. So this is a seriously funny talk, but it will make you seriously think, it will make you reflect, and most importantly, it will get the conversation started. Now, with that, I'd like to hand over, please, to Conrad and Chester.
Thank you so much, Zanele. Thank you. I really appreciate that. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Dive-In. What an honor to be here. Thank you to the entire team, to Lloyd's, AIG, MARSH, Aon, CHUBB. Thank you for having me here. It really is wonderful. So this presentation is a live theater show that's like a talk, basically, on racism. Just a few things before Chester starts, because it's actually Chester Missing's talk. For those of you watching from overseas, Chester Missing is a puppet, yes, You will better watch a presentation by a puppet. Well done. It's like Parliament. That works if you're in South Africa or the UK. We've seen you. So just to start off with, I am aware that I am white, and I obviously, and presenting a talk on racism should raise eyebrows, and that really is what the talk is about. And of course, I'm using humor. Now, just to be very clear, I take racism with extreme seriousness. Racism literally kills black people in South Africa. With Nathaniel Julius' story now, Marikana, this is a continuous story. So the humor is really just a way to deliver the point, as opposed to me taking racism lightly, which I do not at all. So people of color watching, please understand, I come here with respect and humility as far as this issue. Also, it is only an hour, so we'll only be able to cover so much. So if I leave something out, we'll have a discussion session at the end. Please write down any questions you have or thoughts, or it really is just a conversation starter. Also, I'm aware that by focusing on racism as a white person, sometimes we imply that black people do not have agency in this topic. It's not at all where I'm coming from. And so I just to emphasize those issues before I go. As I bring out Chester, I'd just like to send you to the comment section. You see, in comedy online, I cannot see you. And comedy is all about response and interaction. And so the way you can interact is by talking to us in the comments section. So the first thing is, let us know where you're watching us from. Where are you in South Africa or in the world? Just let us know. Go to that comment section and say, I'm in Pretoria, I'm in London, I'm in Swane, I'm in wherever you are. It's a queen. Just let us know. And then the other thing is, I've got a big TV down here where I can see the whole thing going on. So my eyes go down there, that's why. The second thing is, Chester's asked me that during the talk, he's going to ask you a question. He's going to ask you, as a person, to heal race relations in South Africa, what can you do better and what can you stop doing? Don't answer that question yet. Just put it in your mind. What can you do better and what can you stop doing? I'm going to post that in the comment section. To heal race relations, what can you do better and what you can stop doing? We're going to come back to it later. So please go to that Q&A, open up the comment section on the side, and let us know where you're watching from. Just go there, go open it up and let us know where you're watching from. Kenya, well done. Hello, Abraham. That's wonderful. Thank you for joining. Keep it going. The more you interact, the more powerful this will be for you, I guarantee. And I'd like you to please, Tokyo, hello, Yumi from Tokyo, that's amazing. So some of the stuff will be directed at the South African conversation, but the colonialism conversation as far as race is global, so I'm pretty sure you'll get just as much takeaway from it, and I'll explain where the things get confusing. Joburg, hello, Velia. Joburg, Cindy, that's wonderful, thank you. So ladies and gentlemen, please give a warm digital welcome to my friend, Chester Missing, and his talk, A Conversation on Racism. Oh yeah! Oh yeah! Oh yeah! Hello, Divin! Hello! Hello, hello, hello! Please give me that warm digital round of applause. Thank you! Thank you! Thank you! Thank you, everybody! Hello! 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 Hello, Nontutuzelo! Hello! Hello! Hello, Ivana from Benoni! Hello! Hello, thank you! Okay, that's enough. It's getting embarrassing. Okay, no, it's getting embarrassing. It's okay. Thank you. Yes, hello. Hello, my name is Chester Missing. I am a puppet, and I am talking to you from South Africa. Hey, Sionita, love the song. Thank you. Yes, I love it too. As we're doing comedy online in South Africa, because we used to do comedy on our ex-president Zuma, and now we're doing comedy on Zoom, and everyone knows the difference between Zoom and Zuma. Zoom connects you with everyone, but Zuma will just connect you with some people called the Guptas. So thank you for watching. It's wonderful that you're here. Now, this talk is on racism, and we are from South Africa, which is weird. And of course, I have a white South African's hand in my, you know, so it's a bit awkward just to do the talk. No, I can't do the talk unless I ask. Zanele is wondering, Carl, you can't do the talk unless I know if you're a racist. Dude. These people have paid money. They've got people from Tokyo. We've got people from Luxembourg. Everybody's here. You can't just, no, I can't do that. You can't have a racist teaching you how to not be racist. That's literally Boris Johnson and Helen Zille's career plan. All right, okay, you can't tell. What's your thing? Because he's making me talk, guys. I am making his hands literally in my what? Dude. Hey, look, can you see there? Look there. Look there, Sionita. Look there. Hey, it's like I'm Donald Trump and you're Vladimir Putin. No, wait. Don't do Donald Trump jokes. I don't care. He's America's second president of color. Donald Trump isn't of color. Orange is a color. Okay, all right. You get the joke. Did you get the love, Lindsay from Cape Town? Yeah. So what's your point? So, are you racist? You can't ask me that here. Oh, did you see how he looked around? You see how he looked around like that? You see, that's what we do, white people, isn't it? When we talk, if someone accuses us of racism, we look around like a meerkat checking for snakes. And then we say some crazy racist crap like, I'm not racist, but... Yeah, we do. Because you can't say anything after the sentence, I'm not racist, can you? Like, you've never ever seen anyone say to their wife, honey, I would never, ever, ever sleep with your sister. But, okay, guys, I'm not racist. I come from a very liberal family, very liberal part of Cape Town. It's from Rondebosch. I don't know if you guys know Rondebosch. It's in Cape Town. If Rondebosch, let me explain, Japan, Christy, if Rondebosch was a sound, it would be air. It's a sound you make if your cheesecake is stale. Rondebosch is a kind of place you can see some, it's a kind of racism, where you can see someone complain about the temperature of a cappuccino to a dude who lives in a shack. My cappuccino is cold. My cappuccino is cold. Is your toilet on the inside? Yeah, so screw you. Yeah, we don't see ourselves, you're not like that. You're like, you know, it's liberals. Yes, that's the thing. You think you're excluded from our history. You, white people from Rondebosch think they didn't steal the land. They think Pam Golding, the estate agent, did. Okay, wait, all right. Okay. Yeah, we're sort of a little bit condescending. Yes, you're not racist, you're condescending. That's why they put UCT on a hill. University of Cape Town's on hill. Yes, so they could learn to look down at everyone from an early age. What does someone from UCT say when they meet someone from UWC? I don't know. But we're not bigots. No, that's not the point. That's not how racism works. You see, this is the thing, guys. This is the thing. Racism is something most of us think have a big opinion on, but we don't actually know that much about, isn't it? That's the truth. In fact, there's even a website for white people who don't understand racism. What's the website? Facebook. Oh, thank you. Thank you, Sionita. Thank you. I love that joke. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lindsay. Thank you. Okay. All right, what am I not understanding? You see, racism is the fact that in 2012, the South African government shot down 34 miners at a place called Marikana. This is a horrific story. I don't know if you guys internationally know about this, but the South African government shot down 34 miners at Marikana. Or another story, where in 2014, a child called Michael Kamate drowned in poo at his school toilet. This was horrific. It's not really racist. A child called Michael Kamate went to his school toilet and he drowned in feces at school. They've got drop-down toilets in poorer schools in South Africa, like pit toilets. Yes, that's racism. No, that's the ANC government not deliberate. No, that's structural racism, because there are no white kids in Rondebosch drowning in poo. Are there, Martin Machari? There are no white kids in Cape Town drowning in poo. And if they did, Helen Ziller, who is our white politician, should be there the next day. It's the ANC. The ANC did it. It's the ANC. They did it. It's the ANC. Yeah, okay. All right. Okay, I get it. Because that's the thing. I don't do anything that's... You know what that's called? It's called structural racism. And that's most of racism. I know, but I myself am not a bigot. Oh, is he such a bigot? He only eats black jelly babies. No, wait, whoa. You know, you can't just call everyone racist. No, that's because you don't... You know what the thing about racism is, what most of us don't understand? Racism is like if you see a baby in a microwave. If you see someone, Martin, putting a baby in a microwave, and you don't say something, you're collaborating. What? That's how racism works. If you see it and you don't say something, you're collaborating. I bring up racism all the time. I'm clearly, if racism comes up, I talk about, no, he doesn't. No, he doesn't when it's easy. You know, when he's one of those woke a-holes, you crack a joke online, he'll be there like,
You're like, hey, how many people does it take to change a light bulb? And then you'll be like, what if the light bulb doesn't want to change? No. That's easy. Hey, have you tried to tell your boss he's racist, guys? Have you tried to tell your boss he's racist? Hey, boss, you're racist. What a coincidence. You're unemployed. Or try to tell your parents they're racist. Mom, dad, you're racist. You know what doesn't rhyme with racist? No, inheritance. Oh, crap. I challenge racism all the time. That's not true. Yes, no, it's not. He's white, of color. Yeah, my wife says, so you're never going to fight. He's like, you stole my dessert. She's like, you stole my land. My wife and I, you know, we had this, it's, why are you going to tell this? He was at a barbecue, Santa, where, you know, for the overseas people, for the non-South Africans, a barbecue is like, we call it a braai, it's Afrikaans word. And my wife was the only person of color at this braai. It was a terrible, don't tell the story. No, did you guys see that movie, Get Out? It was like that, but with societies. With Cook's sisters and South African things. Yeah, it was weird. Yes, and someone thought they'd crack a joke. They thought they'd crack a little joke, Santa, a little joke. Little jokey joke, little joke. They thought they'd crack a little joke. They said, who gave you permission? This is what their joke was. They said, who gave you permission to cross the color line? And he stood up and he said, how dare you? Those days are over. Come on, honey, we're leaving. No, he didn't. He didn't do a damn thing. Martin from Kenya, he just sat there, did what you're doing now. He just sat there and stared. Yes, okay. As you can hear, it was a shit joke. Oh, okay, wait, all right. It was a terrible moment, but the truth is, it did seem like it was just a joke. Who gave you permission to cross the color line? You think a white South African saying that to a person, and you think that's a joke? Well, it's just hard to doubt. Yes, because that's what racists do, isn't it? Hey, they act like it's just a joke. Like racism is medical aid, and saying it's just a joke is a fine print. Hey, that was racist, didn't you? It was a joke, didn't you read the fine print? It is hard to tell sometimes. No, that's how racist jokes work. Racist jokes are like a heart transplant. Hey, heart transplants are fantastic unless you're the donor. Okay, these guys here, this international dive-in event, they are judging me. Guys, I'm deeply ashamed that this happened. And I've done it more than once where I don't realize that something went down and I don't stand up and say something. And exactly, you know, I'm ashamed that it happened. What? I'm ashamed. It didn't happen. It's not the weather, dude. Racism's not the weather. It's not like farting. Oh, I farted. I'm sorry that happened. You know what racism's like? Racism is like that guy at Virgin Active. Like, it's racism if you see it and you don't say something, you're collaborating. It's like that guy at Virgin Active. Our gyms in South Africa are called Virgin Active. Yes, this guy at Virgin Active a few months ago, he went there and he covered himself with a towel and he started stretching one part of himself, Martin. You understand my meaning? One part of himself very enthusiastically. Kind of crude. Yes, he took the words Virgin Active too seriously. Yeah, anyway. They kicked him out. Yes, they kicked him out. Yes, they said, do not come again. Okay, all right. What's that got to do with racism? That guy's a pervert and he needs help. That is how racism works. Okay, I get it. But my friends, like, I'm not racist. Like, I literally have a master's degree in African culture. Yes, in anthropology, Santa from Durban. Anthropology. It's the study of white guilt. It even has the word apology in it. Hang on a second. Dude, no, hang on, my friends. Most of my friends are of color. I have tons of family of color. You see what he's doing now? Do you see what he's doing now? This is what we do, isn't it, white people? If you accuse us of racism, we start quoting our race CV. I'm not racist. I have a black friend. His name is Jeremy, he's my friend and he's my gardener. It's a complicated relationship. No, man, if you've got a black friend, you probably aren't racist. No, that's a false correlation. False correlation. It's like thinking that because you have a leopard print vest, you're a Zulu taxi driver. Because you drive a Toyota Corolla, you're an Uber driver. Okay, all right. Okay. Do you know what a problem for me with this conversation is? I'm sure some of you watching will relate. You seem to be targeting white people. Yeah? You can't just target white people. It's everyone can be a bit racist. Oh, really? You think black people can be racist? Well, okay, just don't get me wrong. Okay, don't get me wrong. We all learned a little bit of apartheid, but let's be honest. No, black people colonized Europe. Yes. The only black people who colonized Europe is the French freaking soccer team. Yeah, as a result, there's no Germans having to learn Zulu so they can get a job in finance. You've never, ever, 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 ever met anyone called Karen that goes, my name's Karen, but you can call me Sinkobile because it's easier to say.
Yeah, that's true. Okay, I get it. So as a white person, why don't you fix the country by starting with yourself? Okay, all right. But I still don't think I'm racist. But like my friends, you may not know our story, but Justin and I have literally gone to court fighting racism.
Oh, really? You're going to talk? You guys know the story? We're this racist in South Africa. His name's Steve Hoffman.
This is a bigoted singer. Yes, yes. Steve Hoffman. He's like a... I don't know how to say. He's like the KKK with lyrics. Yes, okay. He's a bigot, yeah. And he tweeted in 2014, he said, this is literally his tweet, he said, in my book, blacks are the architects of apartheid. So I tweeted, and Justin's got a lot of Twitter followers, so I tweeted him back, yes, Steve, that is because you haven't graduated about books that you color in. And yeah, that went bananas. Like it proper went viral, went global. Yes, it ended up in court. Now I know what you're thinking, Martin from Kenya. You're thinking he was in court. No, no. Racist idiots, I was in court. Like when the judge said, please rise, I was like, hello. When they said, you swear to tell the truth, he made me say yes.
Yeah, so we won the court case.
No, I am the second puppet in history to go to court.
Who's the first puppet in history to go to court?
Claudie Motsoeneng. Ah, oh, or if you're not from South Africa, Boris Johnson.
Leave Boris Johnson.
Boris Johnson is struggling so much, he interrupts himself.
He doesn't interrupt himself. He talks like he interrupts himself.
Hello, I would like to say, you know, Boris Johnson, I'm, you know, with Brexit and, you know, when we get, you know, with the UK and Corona.
So as you can see, you know, I went to court fighting racism. I'm not racist.
No, dude, no. Nobody who's racist thinks they're racist, Ivana from Joburg. Nobody who's racist thinks that they're racist. In fact, the only way to be sure you're a good person is to be open to the idea that you might be an a-hole.
Okay, wait. My friends, he's not saying that one of you is an a-hole.
No, I am. There's definitely an a-hole watching here today. Martin from Kenya. I'm not saying it is you, but it might be.
Wait.
He's not. On the other hand, he went to Bishop's, a private school in Cape Town, so we know he's an A-hole.
No, how dare you? I'm sorry, my friend. Just give me a moment. How dare you tell this to me? These guys are watching us here. You can't just say I'm racist.
Oh, you see what he's doing now?
No, just wait. This is a fake. I'm sorry. Just give us a moment.
You can't. You've embarrassed me in front of this whole diving.
No, my client, Charlene, you know, the team from Lloyd's. I'm sorry about.
Do you see what he's doing now? Do you see what he's doing now?
What am I doing? You see what he's doing now?
This is called white fragility.
What do you mean it's white fragility?
You see, what we do is if you accuse us of racism, as white people, we overreact. We overreact like a husband who's being caught cheating and is trying to shut that conversation down. How dare you say I've been cheating? How dare you? Do you even have evidence? No. Thank goodness for that.
Yeah, but this is reverse racism. We just assume I'm racist.
It's not reverse racism. How stupid this idea of reverse racism is. You thought about it. If you benefited from hundreds of years of advantage, then fixing that isn't reverse racism. That's like calling a diet a reverse KFC. It makes no sense.
Okay, but the problem is being accused of racism has real life consequences.
Yes, yes. Remember back in the day in South Africa, being racist was part of the job description. Are you racist? Yes, great. Welcome to IISA.
IISA, Barclays. Yeah, I guess, yeah. So you make it hard, like you, so, you know, it's...
No, this is the issue. You see, we spend, and this is a global issue, we spend more time trying to look like we're not racist than we do on actually learning to not be racist. We treat racism like drunk driving. Did you get caught? No. Great. Have another tequila.
Quite a South African thing, that. But, you don't know these people. These are wonderful. Ivana is here. Nontutuzelo is here from, she's from South Africa. We are good people. I mean, you're good people. You're here at a diversity and inclusion event. You're not the problem.
No, that's the issue. We are the problem. That's exactly where the fight is. You see, we define racism as whatever we're not. We think we're good people. So we think, nah, I'm not racist. Racist vote for Donald Trump. I'm not racist, I'm not racist. Racist wear khaki. I'm not racist, I'm not racist. Racist wear the new version of khaki. K-way.
That's South African vibes. Yeah, so you see, like, you can't just generalize.
No, hang on a second. Oh, dude, do you understand how you became a person?
I'm just me.
No, you're not. Dude, you're not an iPhone. The software did not come pre-installed. All your body knows how to do on its own is how to eat, how to sleep, and how to You guys know
What?
At Virgin Active, they call it stretching. I love that joke, Martin. Kenya, I love that joke.
Okay, listen.
So you're saying we copied people? Yes, socialization. We copied people. All those microaggressions you learned from our parents. You know what I mean. People of all races had this. But white people, you know what your parents are like when they see a person of color that like weird like... like Helen Ziller having a poo. That weird face we make. It is a little micro... That is true. We learned that. That's why I love white people's dogs. But white people's dogs are like racism snitches. You're like, I'm not racist. And your dog's like... Arr, 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 arr. He's going, he says the N-word, he says the N-word.
Okay, all right, yes. It was crazy, I travel with this guy. Oh yeah, I know, it's bananas. Like we fly into, we went to Los Angeles. The lady said, because I'm in a suitcase, right?
Sir, do you have anything in the... Chester, do you have the interview politician's other prompt? Have you ever experienced blatant racism? Sunita, that's a good question, Sunita, in the comment section. Yes, I have, actually. All the time I see bigotry. All the time, look at Helen Ziller. I don't see color. I don't see color. And also bear in mind that, our politicians are involved in the system whereby 11 black people were killed during lockdown. I've interviewed Becky Cele. So Becky Cele thinks he's fighting for Black Lives Matter, but meanwhile his policemen, or police people, are killing black people. So that's not anti-racism. We, our government, is part of the structural racism that was perpetuated since apartheid. But I'm going to get there, Sianita. Let's keep going.
But what about like BE?
No, that's just, come on, dude, really? As any, like, BE is not comparable to apartheid. You haven't been dragged out your house, have you? No, no one forced your family from to not do work. I'm going to get there, Sianita. Let's just keep going with the actual show.
But good questions. It's good. This is the idea of the talk. Be interactive. You're welcome to ask questions or share whether you enjoy material.
They're not. They're not. I know.
So we flew into Los Angeles with Chester's in the suitcase.
Yes. And you know how they go, is there anything dangerous in the suitcase?
They said, is there anything dangerous in the suitcase?
So I stuck my head up and I said, yes, Chucky's here.
And they freaked out.
Yes. They said, sir, you can't travel with a puppet, a person in a suitcase. I said, I'm not a person. I'm made out of plastic. She said, yes, you have those here, sir. This is Los Angeles. Everyone is made out of plastic. And then he was like, no, you don't understand. I literally have a guy's hand in my ass. She said, yes, sir. This is Los Angeles. You have those here. They're called actors.
Anyway, so just let's do your talk. Sinita's got some great questions there. Let's do your talk.
Okay, here we go. All right, right. But I got to know before I start, are you racist?
No, I'm not racist. Come on, man. I'm not black guys. I'm not a bigot. This is the way it is. Let's do it.
Okay. You made me go there. All right. Okay.
What?
You know what apartheid did, right?
This apartheid divided us.
No. Guys, let's just get close, right? Because of apartheid, today, white South Africans are on average 5 times wealthier than black South Africans. I'll say that again. Because of apartheid, today, white South Africans are on average 5 times wealthier than black South Africans.
Oh, that's hectic.
I know, it's awkward. People of color, this is a great way to get drinks. White people, I know you're wishing you're watching Netflix. Like people of color, if you use the stack in a bar later tonight, go to a bar and just say to a white, hey, can you buy me a drink? They're going, nah, I'm not going to buy a drink. You know you guys are 5 times wealth. Okay, have a drink.
Okay, listen, man. Sorry, this is racism. You know what my solution is to racism is I don't see color.
You don't see color? No, I don't. Oh, dude, really? Really? A white South African saying they don't see color is like an alcoholic saying they don't see tequila. It makes no sense.
Whoa. Okay. But how do we get over the past?
What? Dude, really? You can't just get over the past by telling people to get over the past. That makes no sense. Next time it's your wife's birthday, don't wish her. And the next day when she's angry, it's in the past, honey. It's in the past. In the history of getting over things, telling people to get over it has never worked.
But the problem is race doesn't exist, does it? This is why it annoys me. There's no such thing as race. It's a sociological figmentation.
That's true. This is what we don't understand. Race is something that white people invented hundreds of years ago that we should have gotten rid of.
What?
Yeah. It's like Irish dancing. No, dude, you guys see that Irish dancing stuff? Check this, like this. Hey, like the epileptic, but just in their legs. Like they're mocking Oscar Pistorius. Dude, don't do Oscar jokes. I don't care. You're the one he's going to shoot.
Lauren, thank you for the positivity. But listen, man. I treat everyone the same. And I think that's what the importance of a diversity and inclusion conference should be.
No, that's the problem with diversity. The word diversity avoids the fact that the issue is that we colonize the place and that racism's the issue. Don't we all love each other? No, we don't. Because it's not white people living in the shacks.
No, but I don't treat people the same. I treat people the same. They're black, green, blue.
No, that's exactly the issue. There are no green people who were sold into slavery. In fact, the only green guy I know is Shrek, and the only black guy in his life is a freaking donkey.
Oh, all right. I don't understand.
You see, we don't understand that while race doesn't exist, racism and culture do. And that's affected opportunity. So if you guys are watching an Olympic race, and there are 9 black guys and 1 white guy, which one of you would put his money on or her money on the white guy? Well, I guess no one, dude. No one. Not even Nelson Mandela, the least racist guy in history, would put his money on the white guy. And if he did, he'd immediately go, never, never, and never again.
Okay, I get it.
Or for example, here's another example, guys. Go, like, let me know, who do you think has made better music historically? Black people or white people?
I don't know, I suppose we both...
No, dude, black people invented jazz, soul, hip-hop, R&B, the blues, they invented rock music too, and then white people stole it. The last white guy to invent his own kind of music was Beethoven, and he was deaf.
Okay, all right, okay. I'm not sure I'm understanding.
You see, we explain race in the wrong logic. You think it's genetic. It's not. It's about opportunity. So while the little black guy was working his ass off, to invent jazz, the little white guy was in Rondebosch playing the triangle. Ding, well done, Jimmy. Ding, well done, Jimmy. Ding, well done. Now get out there and run in this stick.
Or Lloyd's. Yeah. Okay, I get it.
What's your point? My point is, guys, let's get honest. Take me close to the street. You know there are only 2 white South Africans the world knows.
Two white South Africans,
Charlize Theron and Oscar Pistorius.
Oh, no, dude.
Hey, Oscar was a monster. Charlize acted in a movie called Monster. And then she won an Oscar. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lauren. Thank you, Martin from Kenya. Thank you. Hey, I love that joke. Oh. Thank you, guys. Okay, that's enough. It's getting embarrassing. Thank you.
All right, let's do this.
Oh, give them, I got Jacob Zuma as well there. That's Jacob Zuma laughing.
But yeah, okay, I get it. All right, let's do this.
Okay, it's time. Let's do this questions, guys. Go to your comment section. Go to the comment section and answer this question. To heal race relations in South Africa, what can you do better? Like right there, what can you do better? What can you yourself as a person do better? And what can you stop doing? If you're not from South Africa, just make it the way you're from, you know, in the world. What can you do better? And what can you stop doing?
What can you do better as a person? And what can you stop doing?
Like making that crappy accent at black people when you talk to them. When you're working class black to the garage, you go, ish, you talk that crappy Zulu. Takalehos type, you know, that crap.
Or just listen to people's stories,
yeah. Because all races can do better,
all races.
I mean, this guy has a crazy story about doing bad, doing the races.
No, don't tell the story.
Oh, God, you guys know who Luiso Gola is.
So non-South Africans, so Luiso Gola is one of our best comics, he and I. We had a TV show with some other dudes called Late Night News. We just interviewed politicians. And so he was in a bar once in Makanda. Makanda's a university town. We're there for a festival. He was in Grantstown in Makanda. And some black ladies wanted to get past at the bar. And we'd been drinking rum. And you know that rum makes you racist, Martin. It does make you racist. We're drinking at the bar. And these three black ladies wanted to get past. And he said, "Are you people should go the other way?" Because it looked tight. "You people, I don't know. I don't know if you've ever said the words you people to black people, but it doesn't go down well." No, it didn't go down well. They thought you were racist. They did because you were racist. I wasn't racist. No, so he said, "I'm not racist. I'm not racist. I know Loyiso Gola." Oh my goodness. Because you got to choose the right black person if you're going to say, "I'm not racist, I know a black person." What do you say? You can't be like, "I'm not racist, I'm not racist. I know Lucy Maimani." It's not going to work. Oh, God, yeah. Anyway, let's do the talk. So, are you racist? No, I'm not going to talk about that now. Are you racist? I'm not going to do that. Guys, hey, do you know how white this dude is? I want to show you, Martin. This is the whitest guy I know. Show that. I'm going to show you. Show them how white you. Show that. Show that. This is going to blow your mind. Put sunglasses on, Lauren. This is going to blow your mind. Look, show them. Show them. Show them it's diversity and inclusion. It's time to objectify some whiteness. Show them. Look. Oh, my gosh. Did you see that? Dude, if Dulux sold that as a color, do you know what they would call it?
No.
What are you trying to say? Because you know what's become weird in the world? Is being white is, it's normal.
It is terrifying. We have a company called Clicks in South Africa that posted an ad for Tresemme hair products describing white hair as normal.
Yes. What are you saying? Because that's a product of colonialism, isn't it? Like, you think about it. Think that white people are, where we can find us. We're in America, North and South. We're in Australia, New Zealand. We ran India for 200 years. We're in Europe. Like, we're everywhere. We're like pigeons. Except that the white guy who's on your car is not good luck. Because it means you're in like Benoni or freaking Tennessee. Yeah, okay, all right. What's your point? Because here's the issue, guys. Let's go where the rubber meets the road. You know that the Germans lost the war. And they were forced, many of them were forced to go see what had happened. That didn't happen to the English-speaking world. What are you trying to say? Because two Native Australians, Native Americans, and Native South Africans, we are the Germans. That's a, no, dude, it's not ridiculous. We never fought. Why do you think the English are so arrogant that they call the land they stole? They stole the land, and they call it the Commonwealth. You know how insane that is? That's like mugging someone and then going sharing is caring. I mean, Australia still has a thing called Australia Day. How do you know Australia Day is weird? Australia Day, they celebrate. They celebrate the day they stole Australia. That's an a-hole move. That's like hijacking someone's car and then calling them every year to remind them that you've got it. G'day, mate. G'day. Yeah, g'day. Yeah, mate. Yeah. Yeah, we still got it, right? St. Tom, next year, you bastard. And all our popular culture convinces us we're on the right side of history. Because the truth is, in the real world, the dudes in Avatar didn't win. They're working in a call center for Amazon. People from the Amazon are working for a company called Amazon.
Yeah, but you, okay, here's the thing, my friends. You know, we're from South Africa, Sihlale Africa. We're a post-colonial democracy.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Really?
Yes, aren't we a post-colonial?
No, we do. No. Dude, in 2012, the South African government shot down 34 miners at a place called Marikana. Those miners were striking for a living wage. They just wanted to feed their kids. That's all. Those miners were working for a British-owned platinum mine called Lonmin.
Lonmin, you guys. We're striking to get better wages for London.
Yes. I really said that. Yeah. The South African business partner of that London English-owned mine is currently the president of South Africa. Colonialism isn't over. Why do you think his name is Ramaphosa? He's like normal Rama, just much richer. Dude, did you make that face?
Yes.
And did your parents also tell you that if the wind blows, your face will stay that way?
Is that just the South African thing? Your parents go, if the wind blows, your face is there.
Yes, and then you move
to Cape Town and you live in the wind and you find out, no, that is actually the face you make in the wind.
Okay. Yeah, it's just, you know, this idea that colonialism had no good sides, surely that's a bit,
really? Dude, colonialism involved rape, slavery, and genocide. It had no redeeming qualities. The Nazis invented Fanta, the recording Fanta. Did you know that? But that's what makes Fanta taste so nice. It tastes like Nazi. But nobody's going, ah, oh, the Nazis weren't all bad. They gave us Fanta.
Okay, yeah. That bit's much longer than we do the full theater show for the international.
Yeah, it's just awkward, isn't it? It's so awkward, this. Yes, I know. You know what it's like? You know what it's like, people of color, for white people to talk about apartheid and colonialism? What's it like? It's like, you know when you go to your friend's house? You know you go to your friend's house and you have a massive poo. What? Or in South Africa, poo. There's poo in South African word that is a cock. You have a massive cock. And I'm not talking any cock.
Really, dude, it's crude.
No, you need to hear it. I'm talking 4 days of KFC, 2 cheeseburgers, a bunny chow, 5 curries, cock. And it's sitting there like cockzilla. And you flush and it won't go away. Dude, you flush 5 times and it's still there. Now you're freaking out. There's a sweet corn looking up at you going, how's it? They're knocking on the door. They can't come in there. It smells like a human rights violation in there. You're saying, Jesus, take it away, take it away. That is how white people feel when we talk about apartheid. And I guess we don't handle it badly. No, we treat that cuck like we treat apartheid. We cover it in toilet paper. We spray an entire can of air freshener. And then we piss off to Australia and pretend it wasn't us.
Yes, so, can we please do the talk?
So, do you remember apartheid?
You can't ask me that yet. Do you remember it?
This is awkward. Zandele, just watch this. Do you remember apartheid?
Yes, I do actually remember. Oh, this is going to be good. You know, I remember the day I realized I was in apartheid.
Oh, this is going to be crazy.
Yes. You know, I was 6 years old. Do you see that?
Do you see six? Do you know how privileged you have to be for that? Like a kid of color arrived in the 80s, like, oh, I'm here, and it already sucks.
Yes.
So tell us what happened.
Well, my mother said to me, mid-80s, she said to me, Conrad, thank your lucky stars you weren't born black in South Africa.
What? Your mother was a Nazi.
She wasn't a Nazi. She was a nice person.
Okay. She was a nice Nazi.
No, she was saying what you're saying. That I have advantages, you know, that I have privilege.
Exactly. You weren't born an entitled little racist. You had to learn that crap. I'm not entitled. He's so entitled. How am I entitled? Dude, let's go closer there. Look at what he does for a living. What? Look at what he does for a living. Can you imagine a kid of color in the mid-80s going, Mommy, Daddy, I'm going to play with dolls for the rest of my life. Instead of smacking you, though, and that's a wonderful idea, darling, what the world needs is a middle-aged white man who plays with toys.
Yeah, okay.
And here's the crazy thought. This white people, here's the crazy thought. It's not your fault.
What?
It's not your fault.
What do you mean it's not your fault?
Well, you didn't decide to be born white in South Africa, did you?
No,
it's not your fault. You know what racism's like? It's like a, let me think. It's like when you see a kid in Crocs. Have you been to a mall and you see a kid wearing Crocs? Do they have Crocs in Tokyo? Do they have them in Kenya? Do you have Crocs, Martin? Do you have Crocs there?
Yeah, what about them?
Well, that kid, if you do see a kid in Crocs, phone social services. It's a human rights violation. They are wearing Tupperware on their feet.
Yes, so what's that? Why is it like racism?
Because that kid didn't decide to wear Crocs. His mother made it wear Crocs. We're only judging you if you're still wearing Crocs.
But exactly.
And some of you wear your Crocs at home, put another shoes in, you go out, like you do with your racism.
Okay, yes, but this is what I'm saying. I can choose to be different, and that's what I've decided.
No, that's not how it works. It's got to be like an AA meeting. You've got to admit the Crocs are there. You've got to be like, hello, my name's Conrad, and I am a racist. Do you even understand why we created, we have Crocs in Kenya, condolence, Martin, go in the United Nations, you guys need help too.
Look, man.
What's your question? Why did we create apartheid? Do you understand?
we created a party because of racism. No, that's the easy answer. You see, that allows you to blame the racists. No, that's easy. Apartheid was a business plan. Can you imagine those Google reviews? Apartheid, one star. Ordered a black coffee, was given a flat white. Error. What was the business plan? Cheap labor for mines. Like, our white poverty, black poverty was planned by Rhodes and Co. He planned to turn black people into hewers of wood and bearers of water. It was strategic. Europe's wealth and white South Africa's wealth is a direct result of black poverty. Khayelitsha and Rhonda Bosch are directly connected. It's not coincidental. It's direct. Your white privilege is a direct result of black poverty. You can't generalize about all white people. Dude, apartheid was a system of laws. There was no way to avoid it. It was preferential employment, preferential job security, preferential land ownership, preferential education, preferential business rights, preferential voting rights for white people for generations. You took away black people's wealth and stopped them from earning it back. The only way for you as a white South African to not have benefited from apartheid is if you lived in a cave, your family lived in a cave for the last 100 years. And the only way to live in a cave for 100 years is with incest. So you need to decide. Either you benefited from apartheid or your dad is also your cousin. Okay, jeez. Okay, you don't know my family. I don't need to. It's just how it worked. You poor black people. Yes, dude, yes. Yes, yes. Abraham, it was a business. That was literally what it was for. It was to create cheap labor. We used something called the hut tax to force black people out of their traditional economic system. So we charged them money. You can only earn money if you go to work. And if they didn't earn the money, we shot them or put them in jail. So we literally forced black people into our Western economy using guns. And that, and then we paid them less than we could, the absolute minimum wage, and forced them to live in tiny areas called homelands where you couldn't farm enough because it was actually half the size. And Lesotho was three times the size that it is today, 200 years ago. So it's just absolutely so. So yes, Abraham, it was definitely a business plan.
There's a book called Why Nations Fail. If you want to get more, another one called Apartheid, Guns and Money on these issues. You don't know my parents. You don't know. Okay, let's take your example. Did your grandparents benefit from apartheid? So racism was just a justification for the business plan. Yes, but my grandparents didn't benefit. I mean, they didn't work for the apartheid government.
But that's not that. Preferential job security, preferential land ownership, preferential employment, preferential education for like generations.
Okay, and that way they benefit.
Exactly. Did your parents benefit from apartheid? I guess, yes, of course they did. Your dad had no black people when he went to university. When he applied for his first job, there were no black entrants. He had benefited by not being held back.
Okay, all right, yes, in that way, of course, yes.
Exactly. As a result, did you get to study what you wanted to study?
Yes, I did.
Did you get lose a job because of your skin color?
No, exactly.
Has anyone ever judged you because of your accent or how you look and assumed your intelligence based on your identity?
No.
Well, they have. Being white is your advantage. Have you ever had to pay for your dad's retirement? Like, has he got wealthy enough to retire? Yes, exactly. You have to pay what they call black tax in South Africa. You have to look after extended family because they were impoverished by apartheid. No, exactly, dude, your entire life is a product of apartheid. The reason when you are less likely to die of COVID-19 because you can afford to socially distance is because of apartheid. When you're standing in the queue at Woolworths and it's almost entirely black people packing and white people dying, it's because of apartheid. The price of Woolworths avocados is because of, no, I'm kidding, that's got nothing to do with apartheid.
You're freaking people out. Hang on a second. You're making it seem like I didn't work hard. It's not about how hard you work. That's the issue.
Of course you worked hard. It's about a relative scale. You just weren't held back by your race. That's all. It's very hard as a white South African to admit, to acknowledge, to face the fact that we were taught the very way we were educated, the very way we were raised was to see, to think that we own this land. Our national anthem used to be Et die diepte van onze hemel, at the deep of our sky. Et die diepte at the Ditte van Onsea, I mean, at the, it was Ireland, Onsalant.
Exactly.
It's very hard to acknowledge a whiteness, and you're taught to see black people as less capable and therefore inferior. It's very hard to admit that the way you were raised was to see black poverty as normal and therefore justified. The very way we are taught to see black people as less human and therefore less deserving of human rights, black lives matter. It's very hard to acknowledge, and the worst amongst us are liberal, progressive white people, because we think this doesn't apply to us. We think it's those people over there who need to hear this. But we're the ones causing the worst damage to people of color, because we're the ones who are less capable of self-reflecting. You know what it's like when your friend is racist? It's like getting mugged in a police station. Although this is South Africa, that could actually happen. Okay, I'm hearing what you say. The social advantages that have come from the economic system of apartheid. Exactly. I mean, think about it, guys. What does Danny Kaye actually do? Nothing. He's like this guy. He lives on white privilege alone. Danny Kaye is like our boy band. For those who are not from here, I've got to appeal to someone. What? You know, I understand. I just think that sometimes using an excuse, people can like, no, dude, listen, do you know that like we're from Africa, right? We live in I'm in Africa right now. 6 out of 10 senior managers in South Africa, in corporate South Africa, 6 out of 10 senior managers is white. We're only 8% of the country. In other words, if you're going to make it in your career, you've got to convince a white person to trust you. It's likely that's going to happen. Why do you think we have an entire brand of clothing called Country Road? Country Road, clothes to make white people trust you. Yeah, I guess that's true. No, it's totally true. Like, trust me, people of color, like, if you want to, like, if any people from overseas, Abraham, if you come to South Africa, go to Woolworths, our most extensive store. If you want to fight racism, black people, you can all do this. Go out to white people in Woolworths and go, do you work here? Yeah, I guess that's true. Is that we have, like, we have kind of capital. Yes, it's called social capital. We're more likely to know someone who's in business just because of historic connections. That's why we even have a guy called Joshua Dorr who calls himself the uncle in the furniture business. And Joshua Dorr looks like F.W. de Klerk. Yeah, I suppose. It's just so hard to explain sometimes. Like, let me put it this way, guys. Let me put it this way. You know why it's hard, why we're so tiring to a lot of people of color, white people? It's because we're all doing these little microaggressions. In different ways, at different levels, but we are all doing them. And what it becomes like is when you phone a call center, if you phone a call center and you've got to phone 10 times because you never get through and you explain the same crap over and over and over again. Yes, that's what it's like. It's like, why do you think the company's called Amazon? Because if you call them, you'll never get through. It's like those people who go, now all lives matter. Yeah, you know the people who go, all lives matter. If someone says all lives matter to you, Abraham, you have my permission to steal their car. And when they go, oh, my car got stolen, you say, no, sorry, all cars matter. And they go, no, you don't understand. My car's green. You say, yes, but I don't see color. And then they'll go, no, but how are you going to know which car is stolen if you don't see color? And then you go, exactly. We do weird things. Like, it's a weird thing that some older white people do is, you know, when your auntie says to your black friend, ah, Chitu, Chitu, his name's Seto, she'll call him Chitu, Chitu, you speak so well. That's what she'll say, you speak so well. And then, and she doesn't mean you speak well as in you're a good speaker. She means, thank goodness you don't sound like Julius Malema. Like, thank goodness you sound like you've been colonized. Thank goodness you've been assimilated. Is when there's a weird things that happen when that happens. Yes, because the thing she says after you speak so well is always, you're one of the good ones, hey? You're one of the good ones. Oh, dude, it's terrible. Yeah, I'm getting the gist of what you're saying. I mean, guys, like, we do so many little things. Like, for example, the funniest accents in South Africa are always accents that are working class people of color. To a white South Africa, to a middle class South Africa, because it's class and gender are connected in these things. But to a middle-class South African audience, to working-class black, Indian, and what we call mixed-race colored accents are seen as funnier. Like, if you say those accents, that's always the comedy routine. And the reason is that because we see a middle-class-sounding accent and a whiter accent often as normal. That's all that's going on. It's so sick. It's like the Germans colonizing you
200 years later, going to a comedy club, and then laughing at your crappy German accent. Oh, they are so funny when they're colonized.
Yeah, it's so hard. But we need to come together, Chester. This is what this is about today. This is about, you know, it's about seeing each other in a way that's inclusive.
Yes, but that takes you doing some hard work.
Well, I am, but I think that we need to come together, right? Don't we need to come together?
Yes, but that's what the Rainbow Nation narrative that we had in South Africa was. It was a pretend come together. It wasn't a come together that acknowledged who bore the brunt of the party. I mean, you know how insane it is that colonialism and apartheid happened and we never paid back a cent.
Oh, okay, but hang on a second. I think you're being divisive. You know, we are all Africans.
Oh, you're an African?
Yes.
Really? I'm an African. Dude, this dude is African in the same way as tomatoes are a type of fruit. It's true that nobody gives a damn. I'm African. Okay, Mr. African, sing the national anthem. I'm not going to sing now. He doesn't know the words.
I know the words. Are just some bad singer. He sings it like a rugby player.
Nkosi sikilili Africa.
Come on, man. I am an African.
Please, dude. Really, if you're so African, how many African languages do you speak?
Well, I mean, Kukuluma Sizulu.
No, not that crap you do at the garage. I mean, fluently. Because, I mean, let's go all in. Let's be honest with each other. We are the 11 official languages. How many of us can even name the languages? There's English, Afrikaans, always start with those two. Xhosa, as they call it in Santon. Xhosa, Zulu, Sotho, Tswana. Now, huh? What's next? Be honest, do you have an idea? No. Mandoza, was he a language? No, he was a person, and he spoke in Kalakata.
Yes, okay, wait. What do you want me to do? Like, what will it take for us to come together, Chester? What must I do? Must I apologize for apartheid?
Yeah, do it.
I'm going to do it online. No, do it. Okay, I'll do it. My friends,
who's watching here? Mpumalelo, watch this out. Thank you. Big fan of you too, Mpumalelo. Check this out. He's going to apologize.
I am deeply sorry about apartheid.
Did you see that?
What?
Jack, all happened! Dude, it changed nothing! All it did is let your conscience off the hook.
What do you want me to do? Give him Ponalelo
your house. Come on, dude. Even OutSurance paid something back.
Don't say that. We're in a competition platform.
I don't care. I don't get any of the cash. Feels like apartheid up here.
Okay, all right. I get it. We need to actually contribute. We can't just say platitudes.
No, exactly. We need to do everything we can because it's crazy. It's a party that took away people's dreams. How do you pay that back? You can't, you know how many schools you have to paint to give back dreams? So it's, that's just the hardest. You're about racial humility. It's about realizing that you're part of this country. It's not your fault. But, you know, it is shameful what's happened.
That is true.
So are you going to admit it? What, are you racist?
I'm not. Wait, guys, listen, man. As Zanella said, at the beginning or when Chester and I went to court with Steve Hoffman, we literally received an award from Ahmed Kathrada. Ahmed Kathrada was in jail with Nelson Mandela for 26 years. We got an award from a dude who's in jail with Madiba for 26 years for fighting racism. I'm not racist.
Oh, really? Dude, racism doesn't work that way. Racism is like farting. It's judged on a per thought basis. You can't fart and then go, oh, I held a lot of thoughts in the past. That's literally Helen Zille's career plan.
So what do you want me to do? I'm talking about apartheid, I'm talking about privilege, and
yes, you benefited from apartheid. And here you are being paid, benefiting from talking about apartheid again. It's like apartheid squared. It's not a comedy show, it's cake net with jokes.
So you're saying that I must actually not talk about race?
No, sometimes I think you can be quiet. This is a white person, sometimes. Just have some humility and be quiet. Think about it. When Martin Luther King, stood up there and said that iconic speech, I have a dream. You didn't need a white guy to jump up and go, you guys know what dreams are, hey? We're all clear on dreams.
Okay, all right. Get it. I get it. Okay. So what now?
one done. These people have paid to see your talk or conversation. I'm not going to do it. Thank you. Sorry about this. Thank you. No, dude, really? No, it's done. They paid money. No, thanks, guys. Bye. I can't. Sorry. I'm just not going to collaborate with this. I'm done. Dude, what? I don't know. What am I going to do? I don't know. Go start a soup kitchen. But all I know how to do is jokes. Start a soup kitchen with jokes.
Okay, my friends, just give me another 2 minutes and we'll wind this up in a really positive, fun way. I've got a fun thing we can do. We won't deal with race. How unfair is this? What?
So you're not going to deal with the race?
No, we're not going to deal with race. You told me not to.
You see how easily you walked away from it.
What do you say?
People of color can't do that. Look at Nathaniel Julius.
What do you mean?
Well, you can't look how hard and easy it is for you to not deal with race. That's what white privilege is.
So you're saying I'm in crap if I talk about race, and I'm in crap if I don't talk about race?
Yeah.
Well, how is that fair?
Well, look on the bright side. What's the bright side? You've still got the land.
Okay, I'll do it.
What?
I'll do it.
Okay, say after me.
Yep.
Hello, my name is Conrad.
Hello, my name is Conrad.
And I am a racist.
And I am a racist.
Okay, great.
Yep.
Martin from Kenya's turn now.
That was a conversation on racism by Chester Missing. Thank you for engaging. We'll go back to some of these questions and comments that you've made now with Zanele's help, but I'd just like to end this off before you come in, Zanele. I'll transfer the tech stuff. My intention with this is not to say that anyone's bad or good. It's to provoke a conversation that I need to start, that I can start. Just in every healing, start with yourself. And as white South Africans, I think the most powerful thing we can do is to acknowledge and own what has happened. Because if we don't, we're saying the reason poor black people are living in poverty is because they didn't work hard enough or have some less talent or intelligence that we have, which is clearly not the case. The reason for the inequality, apart from ANC continuing structural racism, is the fact that this was enforced with guns. The Rainbow Nation, in my view, is a goal we're working towards, not a place we have reached. I hope that we can all open our hearts and to see this with security and without being terrified of just acknowledging the truth of what has happened in this country. With all my love, that was thank you for listening. And please, we'd like to invite you to, I know this is quite provocative, we'd like to invite you to comment and ask questions, and we'll engage with you. Zanele, I'm going to throw over to you. If you guys just give me a moment while I have my text all done here. Zanele, where are you there? Can't see you on my list. It says WebEx producer. Can I go over to you? Zanele, you can turn your mic on. You're on mute, Zanele.
Okay. Great stuff. I'm here. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Conrad. Thank you so much, Chester. Provocative indeed. I think that these are very uncomfortable conversations, but like I said, conversations that need to be had. We're going to spend the next 30 minutes just unpacking some of the stuff that you've said. We're going to interview you. I don't know if Chester will be joining the interviewing as well, but let's talk. Okay. We've got a comment from Abraham. Abraham Ochieng. Abraham says, Conrad, what do you mean this was a business? I suppose he's talking about your comment with regards to apartheid being a business plan and a strategic one at that and a very intentional one at that. So perhaps if you can just unpack that for us a little bit. But what I want to also get out is, do you think then that the undoing of it requires a similar strategic business plan and intent?
So let's, that's a great follow-up question, Zanele. So let's start off with the business plan. You see, the reason this is important is that the repercussions of colonialism and apartheid were financial. And when you ignore that and act like racists are bad people, you see, I'm seeing a better way to explain this. The way everyone who's racist avoids ever taking on and facing their racism is by defining racism as something that's got nothing to do with them, as blaming those bad people, those Trump supporters, those people over there. But the truth is, racism is a structural societal issue that pervades our culture.
The mere fact that this entire conversation in Africa is happening in English is because of normalized colonial racism. So what we need to do is step back and go, what actually is racism? That's the first thing. Racism is the inequality that means that Nathaniel Julius will get shot down by the police for merely being a brown kid with cookies, which happened in South Africa recently, or black people in the streets during lockdown, but white people will be protected. And it's because of our economic power that no one's, you know, the resources just flow our way far more easily. Our bodies are seen as safer, and that is an economic power. That's why we're talking English. If you go to East Africa, you're more likely to have the conversation in Swahili because there's more economic power in that direction. So it's in the same way, why is apartheid a business plan? It's because that was the plan. The plan was to extract gold from the gold mines. I mean, that's why the English killed the Boer was because they wanted to protect their interests in Johannesburg and so gold mines. So. And now it's another set of genocide I didn't get into is the attitude of English-speaking South Africans that we didn't benefit, when clearly white South Africans are the wealthiest, most financially secure, safest, best healthcare, most access to education people in the country. So the legacy of apartheid lies in finance. And because we avoid that by blaming it on those bad racists, as opposed to us collaborating in a system that allows us to think we're good people as white South Africans, when meanwhile our lives are built on blood, tears, and destroyed dreams, which isn't my fault, but once I know it's the case, pretending it isn't the case, that is your fault. You're aware now, you can do something about it, which then leads us to your question, what can we do? Now, my problem is, Zanella, I'm an anthropologist, I'm not an economist. So there's a huge amount of furore about, oh, BE doesn't work, ball based, where most people don't understand BE. They think it's just ANC giving stuff to their friends, which is part of it, but it's actually not all of it. So there's a lot of good it does in certain situations in a very white work environment. Very hard for people of color to get traction. How do you think we got this clicks advert? Just because a person of color is involved in creating it. There were black apartheid police. Black people participate with white supremacy all the time. So what is the answer? Does it require a wealth tax, reparations, etc.? Something's required. I'm not qualified to say what. I'm just trying to get us to be conscious to the idea of humility in this conversation and that something needs to happen. Because trickle-down doesn't work. We believe that, well, if we just build the economy, poor people will get wealthy. But around the world, that's been said, it's neoliberal economics. It just doesn't have the effect we claim it will. I think we can do better than what we're doing. I think the ANC is screwed up. But the most powerful thing you do is separate the two conversations. Start with yourself and then start with the larger conversation. I don't know if I've answered that.
100%. Because something like this does not just exist at that structural or institutional level. It begins with the self. It starts at a very real psychological level. You were mentioning something around white people feeling or thinking that black people are inferior. Let me look. You said they are taught to see black poverty as normal and black as inferior, etc. And that to me, number one, is a mindset. If I can just take you through a journey of a typical black person raised in the apartheid era and trying to succeed post the apartheid space, we have been taught or are teaching ourselves and teaching our children to not believe the lie. Because for me, the great lie was that white is superior and black is inferior. As black people, we need to change that mindset and do not believe that we are inferior. So on the converse, white people from a psychological level need to start believing that they are not superior. Is that in essence what you are saying?
Yes, Sanele, but I like to make sure that I don't say white people, which is true, it is white people, but it's me. I need to learn to not feel superior, because as soon as I start pointing fingers, people often feel like I'm talking about someone else, but I'm not. I can see the ways I have been taught to assume authority, to assume, and it just comes out. I've rarely thought about this, so it's just, you have to constantly get up every day and go, be aware of the ways where my advantages are seen as normal. Because I think there's a subtle additional thing here. which goes with the idea of merit. So in other words, I feel merit hides the idea of white supremacy. It's not that merit is wrong, it's just the way it's applied forgets that we are not starting from the same playing field. I mean, I went to very nice schools in the southern suburbs. I had massive advantages. So in spite of the fact that I work really hard, it doesn't mean, it basically what it means is this, to sum up what you're saying, is my wife, who's a woman of color, any day she has is easier than any day I have, almost without, so I can never complain. So this whiny complaining hides white supremacy because it implies, for example, oh, the ANC, they're terrible. It's like, yeah, but your life is built on black poverty and tears. What are you doing acting like you're better than the ANC? Yeah, complain, nail them, absolutely. But just don't think you have the moral high ground. And that hides the white supremacy. So it hides in micro little moments that I participate in just as much as anyone else.
Understand. Has this show, this conversation, how has it been received so far? When did you start this particular show? And are you finding that you are getting what you are hoping to get out of it? Are you finding that it is indeed a conversation starter? Certainly in the circles that you hang out in, have you seen the impact of this show?
Well, lockdown happened just as the show was being launched, so it had to turn into a whole virtual thing. I couldn't give you the full version today because we had some issues with the WebEx system, and I bring a lot of video and stuff. But yes, it has had impact within people who are willing to hear and see. What I've learned to do is not fight racists online like the Steve Hoffman thing, because I think the two white men shouting about race actually just gives white people, centers us as so to speak. So what I found is if you speak to the people who, and I think a lot of white South Africans do care and would like to know how to handle this, and I found that those people, when I can reach them, like today or other events that I do, they've started to really listen. I found some school events where people have started to listen. So I found that talking to people who have the eyes to see and the ears to hear has been incredibly effective, because having someone who says this, they just, you know, Helen Ziller should have said this stuff. De Klerk should have said this stuff, but they didn't. So we need to collectively say this stuff. And I find that that does have impact. I'm not going to lie. I do get a lot of hate. I get told how talentless I am by the right wing continuously. They put my street address online. They go after you. But that's just that fringe. There's plenty of wonderful people in South Africa who do want to make this country work.
Yeah, it certainly cannot be an easy place to be, I can imagine. I would love to start hearing from the participants. Please type in some questions. I'm going to read one now from Sionita. Sionita says, and this one is for Chester. Chester, you have interviewed politicians and other prominent South Africans. Have you ever experienced blatant racism? Interesting question from Sionita.
So just as a dangerous one there, a good one, yes, politicians can be blatantly racist. I mean, Cyril Ramaphosa was involved in Marikana. That's blatant structural racism. As far as the danger is, what starts happening is white South Africans have started telling themselves that Julius is the same as apartheid. That's crazy. No one's being dragged out their homes. No one's dad isn't getting to progress with their career in real terms. I mean, I say B, but it's not even, I mean, do you have a passbook? I mean, like, it's preposterous. There's no District 6 for white people. So the danger with that is that it goes, you know, a bit of political screaming, which is wrong, and it speaks to a kind of racial national, wrong at a certain level. So that's where I'm cautious. So yes, I have seen blatant racism, but in general, by far the biggest pushback as far as racism I've seen is from the DA and kind of white obliviousness. And it's got to do with this entitled presumptuousness. I do see, I very seldom see black people saying, the ANC has a very, you know, universal, in, you know, this, it's kind of, yeah, ACE will say some stuff in the right rally. But, you know, the concept of non-racialism that's politically aware, it's quite a complex issue. So I think that there is like a racial nationalism. I do hear people saying racist stuff about what we call people overseas, what we call color, mixed race people. And I see that kind of racism going all over the place and sometimes, but it's seldom politicians know how to play the game. So they're a little bit better with Chester, he'll keep going. And then
they don't stand a chance if they start doing racial nationalism. So that hasn't really been.
Okay. All right. Thank you for that. Okay, I've got a couple more questions coming in.
He's lying, Sanele. He's lying. I see racism all the time. Have you turned to Gwede Montashe? Oh, he's such a bigot. He sounds like a chapter. I love Gwede Montashe, Sanele. I love your earrings. Are you watching by DSTV? Because you're wearing the dishes on your ears.
Oh, my word. No, not quite. Just African deco. It's heritage.
I love it. Heritage, man. Amanda. Viva. Amanda. Okay, I'm going back to watch puppet porn. That's what I do in my spare time.
Thank you. Oh, gosh. I've got Mpumelelo. Mpumelelo's got a question with regards to Chester. He says, hi, Conrad. When you initially started, Chester was a colored/black man. But he changed to a white man, I've also noticed, with blue eyes. Did this change allow him to say more provocative truths, a wider audience perhaps, more wealth perhaps? Interesting question from Mpumelelo.
That's a great question. Thank you, Mpumelelo. So this show is only an hour, but the live show is an hour and 20 or so, and I actually talk about that conversation in the full show because it's a very important part of a reflection on myself. So for people overseas, Chester used to be mixed race, what we call colored, in the way I framed him in my head. Now, I totally understand the issues there. Or maybe I didn't, but I definitely do now. So the concept was it was a brown puppet nailing me for my white privilege. So his fans are all black. I mean, he has 99% black fans, interviews Gwede Montashe, Ramaphosa, et cetera, on TV. The problem is that by invoking, he had an accent at first, by having an accent and claiming identity, while he was high status, it was clearly blackface in that he was a funny character and colored people are continuously being treated like, you're a jovial person. So that confirmed racial nationalism. It also, people who do actual race, because the joke was never his accent. You weren't laughing at him for being him. You were laughing at him nailing me. But I'm still appropriating. This was years ago. In order to progress with him overseas, and he would call me out for blackface in the live show. Of course, that has a time frame. Part of my understanding of this, right or wrong, is that like Bordeaux, the sociologist, you know, culture of tastes, black South Africans really enjoy a brown Chester nailing a white Conrad. I mean, I did Blacks Only and got milk, which is a comedy show we have here with, which is entirely black audience, where I get massive standing ovations for unpacking these issues, but doing it with a brown puppet. The hurdle with it is once I've had that conversation about blackface, that conversation was over. And the only way forward was just to unmask and say, no, he forced me to be black in order to get shows. Does it make white people like me more? No. Are you listening to what I'm saying? And that's also racial nationalism. It's got to be white if white people were like it. It's got to be brown if brown people like it. It's not actually how it's unfolded. He's the same thing because eventually Chester's a latex puppet, not a race. He's me. So the problem was the appropriation and the kind of concept of brown of colored people as jovial. Totally not okay. And I have sadness that I contributed to that in any way whatsoever. And if you're a colored person watching, I am deeply sorry. And I, you know, I'm trying to face myself here. But that being said, the reason he's white is because it's actually a more powerful conversation and a longer term one. We can talk more about gender as a two male dudes type thing, and we can talk more about poverty as a thing without you continuously having to reference the fact that the puppet's brown.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, and what I like about you and Chester going at each other, it's almost a metaphor of what I can imagine is one's own internal conversation and internal conflict around the issue of racism. Because, you know, one part of you might feel X and another part of you might feel Y. But ultimately, it's a reflection. And ultimately, we all need to one take some sort of a stand after the reflection. And what I like about this is that it gives us an opportunity to see that reflection almost real. And a lot of us, I would imagine, will be asking ourselves questions. I'm imagining a lot of our white participants will be asking questions because, you know, the whole repertoire is around, I suppose, admitting to one's own racism as a bigger structure, as being about opportunities. It's not just whether you said something racist or you've been caught saying something racist. It is really not about that. Identifying or owning up to white privilege, I suppose, is also a start. Part of the repertoire, you also said that, or rather, Chester asked you to apologize, which I thought was, it was tense, or rather, I received it as very tense. Now, do you think that is where the starting point is for individuals? Do you really believe that is where it starts? Although you acknowledge that it's not the end and it does not change anything, is that a starting point?
That's a good question, Zanele. Thank you. I think it's a starting point. What I think the starting point is a sense of shame of having any association with the system. Mm-hmm. Shame's been spoken about a lot in this conversation, you know, in other places. It's not guilt. It's just like, it's a shameful thing that you feel, you know, and to just be quite blunt about this, the kiffness, the sort of mildly right world, the right wing satirical musician who I've never seen in a comedy club, but the kiffness, he's got this idea that, you know, I have my privilege, but I don't feel bad about it. I'll use it to help black people, which is called saviorism. It's the idea that, no, actually, I don't feel discomfortable that I have privilege. I feel that this advantage is given to me. I am ashamed that this has happened. When I stand there at Woolworths and I look at the person packing, I don't feel okay about that. I feel awkward and uncomfortable and that this is wrong and that I do not like collaborating with this. I don't, and that feeling, so to go, should you apologize? Yes, but to who? And then in general, it's just performative. So that uncomfortableness of being a white South African and living with this is just part of who you're going to be. That it's as Hannah Gatsby, the amazing Australian comic, says, is that for white men in particular, this discomfort is something everyone else has lived with socially for years. That's what being white and male is. It clicks or make hair ads where you treat it as normal. So in other words, that uncomfortability is more of just being sitting in it and not whining about it, and not sitting and complaining about how hard your life is because I'm not living on 350 rand a month the government's giving me. I think that, and then acting on that, like chatting to other white people, challenging it, using burning bridges if you have to say, no, I'm sorry, boss, that's not okay, and then you won't get a promotion because you saw racism happen, and that's where you can use it. You can make yourself less white and use your privilege in a way that doesn't attract attention, but rather seeks to undermine the system of advantage. Versus apologizing kind of seems like a performance to let yourself, I apologized, I'm done. No, you're not. But I think the act of the seeing it as a bad thing, as opposed to apologize, if you understand what I mean, it's got to do with the tone which you live with as opposed to a once-off event.
100%. Got you. Okay, we've got more questions. I've got another question from Zoe Siloko. The question is, what do you think white people are being taught at their homes for racist behaviors to still persist after so many years since the end of apartheid?
Well, nothing ended. I mean, look, my life didn't really change. It's like, so to go, well, something changed. No, it didn't. White families just continue doing what white families do. So in other words, it's something that's, I'm in the media a lot. You know, I had my own TV shows, et cetera. And we can ring fence our experience as white people because we have the money. So people know we have the money. So in other words, I can't get on Jacaranda FM because I'm scared I'm going to say this stuff. Same way as Tumi Morake got kicked off, not kicked off, but she sidelined off Jacaranda. She left, yes, voluntarily, of course. So it's that, but I literally can't get on. So it's got to do with we are raised in an environment where we can only see references that make ourselves feel safe. And so those prejudices are just kind of never questioned, because where would they be questioned? They're not going to hear it on the radio station you listen to, because if you do hear it, you'll change radio stations. Your Facebook feed will confirm what you want to hear. So unless your family directly says to you, this is what's gone down, and our education system doesn't overtly explain, this is what apartheid gave you. You know, if you go to, you know, 100, let's take some numbers, 187 of the top 200 schools in this country are previously white, Model C as they call them schools. 57% of the children at those schools are white. It is very easy to never really, black people, the way I see it is black people are let into white spaces, often workplaces, banks, etc., one at a time. So in other words, I mean, Zanella, I really don't have to explain this to you, but I mean, I'm sure you've experienced this, but what's going on is people are arriving, and there isn't this is sort of white people, there isn't the cultural mass to enforce assimilation, which is why we're still talking English, and you don't need to speak an African language and live in this country. So we aren't actually being changed, and in order to change it, it needs a large enough sound of kind of like what I'm saying here, and more people like me to noble me, they're really, it's so pretentious, but more people saying the stuff that needs to be said. To disrupt them. So that moment at the braai, when you see your family, you're like, nah, nah, speak. That's when it counts. That moment, that's when you speak.
Very interesting. We are running out of time, so I'm very mindful of that. I would love to actually continue. I'm going to take a final question, because I think this is a great question to end the conversation here, from Colleen Kanya. Colleen says, it would be interesting to get a view. Are we changing and moving in the right direction? Or are we living in oblivion, thinking that the dreaded damage of apartheid will unravel within our nation? Are we changing? Are we moving in the right direction? As a final comment.
This is a difficult one, Colleen, because, and it's exactly what white people got.
You're just dividing the nation. You're saying that you're making the pain come back. We keep focusing on apartheid.
But that's not the intention. The intention is to just deal with it. And then you've dealt with it. Now my life is much easier because I don't have weird, no, I have moments all the time, but I don't have weird vibes with anyone of color because it's just like, yeah, that happened. We don't have, there's a German with Weltanschauung, a German sociological work with Weltanschauung. It's like a worldview. We don't have a shared worldview where we actually see this country. We do need a new social compact. So we are moving forward. But the idea that black people going apartheid was wrong and affected my life, like I could talk about my wife or any of, I mean, isn't it a family who didn't study what they wanted to study and now are doing jobs they didn't want to do? How do you say get over that? So we just acknowledge that pain and do everything we can to fix it. Then we don't have to keep having this race conversation. The reason we keep having the race conversation is because it's just not being acknowledged. So it's like there's a block. You just take away the block, we'll move forward. And I think we are moving forward. So the DA-ish kind of non-racial crap is being faced. At the same time, I think black people are going, whoa, Julius, we need a way to fix this that isn't you trying to get VBS tenders out of it. So in other words, There is a middle ground we're working towards. I think black people can have a conversation about how to deal with the legacy of apartheid. I think me as a white person, I need to make sure that my conversation is about facing the past so that there's space for black people to have that healing and we can move on. But unless we heal, we won't move on.
That's it. There we have it. Acknowledge the pain and let's fix it. Those are the closing comments from Conrad. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Chester, where is he? It was good to have you guys.
I wish I had been here the whole time. I don't know what he was saying to you, but it was probably lies. Probably lies, to be honest.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Chester. You've given us a lot to think about.